So hi guys, Jonathan Grimm here for Guitar Interactive Magazine. We're here with the one and only Mark Tremonti.
What's
the
happening?
King of Download 2023. How
are
you doing?
I don't know about the king. Good, how are you?
I'm good, man. It's always great to see you. Like you guys, you are just like a mainstay for Download. You know, it's when the lineup gets announced, you're always expecting that Alter Bridge are going to be on there. Can you just talk a little bit about how important this festival has been for you guys and over the years?
Yeah, I think it's been the most important festival of our careers. You know, it's been really an anchor for us on any given tour, and it's exposed us to so many people that now have kind of, we've built this great fan base in the UK, and I think Download had a lot to do with it.
And on the bill today, I feel like it's a real, like there's a lot of your friends here tonight,
yeah.
And it makes it almost a little bit of an extended, you know, Alter Bridge solo show. And I said, you got Wolf on today, yep. Hailstorm, you guys have played so many times. You're just missing Blackstone Cherry for the full house.
Absolutely.
But, just talk a little bit about sort of playing with these guys throughout the years and what have been some special moments in sharing the stage with them?
Yeah, you know, Wolfie's, he was kind of like my little brother of sorts at sometimes. I've known him since he was a tiny guy, you know. So to see him now on stage in front of, 50,000 people right now, doing it and killing it, makes me happy. You know, it's great to see him
Absolutely.
Doing so well. Garrett's out there playing drums with him that, you know, played with me and Tremonti as well. Hailstorm, we've known since they were kids. I remember them crashing at my house when they were first on their way up, you know, shy kids, you know, and now they're dominating the world. And it's just good to see all the hard work that pays off with your friends, you know?
Yeah, no, for sure, yeah. For sure. Now, I don't want to take all the time talking with you and talking about other people, but I do need to talk a little bit about Metallica because they've headlined Download, you know, a couple of times, but this one feels like a pretty special one with the two nights and the different sets. Share some of your experiences with playing with Metallica over the years and even, you know, just hanging with them.
Yeah, so Metallica's my favorite band of all time. They were the band that made me a music fanatic. First time I played with them was down, I believe, in Tampa at a big outdoor festival. But since then, I've probably now gotten to share the stage with them a dozen times, and every time it's just incredible. And, you know, I've gotten to speak with the guys briefly here and there, and every time I don't take it for granted, so it's a wonderful thing. Hopefully tonight I get to see the whole set.
You got a favorite Metallica moment over the years?
Probably when they did the Master of Puppets anniversary show where they played it from front to back. My favorite Metallica song is Orion, and I never thought I'd see it live, but man, I was counting down the songs to Orion, so seeing Orion live is my highlight.
Was that here?
Because
they did do that, I think, 2006 here at Download.
I don't know exactly where it was. It was a whole tour they were doing it.
So you caught it. You caught it there, absolutely. Now, we're coming fastly approaching, incredibly, 20 years since the first Alter Bridge record. Now, you guys, you're always pushing things forward. You're always looking ahead. But got to be taking a little bit of a moment to celebrate that record next year, surely. Have you got some things planned?
You know what, it just so happens to be an off year for Alter Bridge, so we'll have to figure out how we can do something to celebrate that. Whether it's a night of playing One Day Remains front to back, or who knows, but we definitely got to talk about it.
Yeah, no, for sure. What's your stage set up tonight? You're going to be PRS front to back, but what you got out there?
I've got my new signature amplifier. It's called the MT-100. I'll have it up there. I've got it covered so you can't see what it looks like yet, because it's not going to be announced, I think, until October, maybe.
I take it this thing comes with a bodyguard. Yeah,
it's
you know how many people want to try and get hold of this?
We have been working on it for 4 or 5 years now, painstakingly going through it, making sure everything's perfect. So it's I love it. I think when it comes out, I think people will enjoy it.
So you're keeping it hidden? You're keeping it hidden tonight?
They want to be able to release it with a big splash, and if I've already put it out there, it's not.
When are we going to see it, Mark? When are we going to see it? Like within the next 6 months?
Hopefully October. You know, that's the time we've been talking about. Yeah. I just approved the cabinet, so I want it from top to bottom. I want everything from the tubes to the components to the amp to the tones to the speakers to the cabinet to the woods to everything to be perfect. So We've been, we just finally got the manufacturing figured out for the cabinets. When I get home from this tour, the one will be waiting at my house to make sure it's greenlit. I've greenlit the version I put together. So now when they go through the actual manufacturing, we'll see if it matches.
Yeah. Now, yeah. Did we get to hear the MT-100 on Pawns and Kings?
Yes, it has
featured on there.
A version of it. Okay. It wasn't the final version.
Okay.
The overdrive channel has changed a lot since then, but
okay. But
the dirty channel and the clean channel are pretty similar.
And I think the thing is, I think it does say an awful lot, you know, about how, you know, it has been years and the attention to detail with this. You know, you weren't going to do this until it was right. And
yeah.
We know that Paul is another stickler for
yeah.
things being exactly how they are. Is he... I know he'll have been hands-on with the actual getting the thing done, but
yeah.
has he sort of stepped back and just allowed you just to do what you want
yeah.
with this?
I think me and Paul have different tastes in guitar
yeah.
amplifier tones. You know, his me and him we get along great because just recently I bought a microphone of his, and We tried out all his microphones, and the one that I chose, he's like, all right, fine, I'll sell it to you. So he had to find this. There's only like 12 of these things in the world.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's a stickler for tone. And one day we got into the studio, into the factory, and we were working on the overdrive channel. I brought in my Dumble, and I was like, I want this to sound... You know, everybody's tried to make a Dumble, right? Nobody's done it correctly other than Alexander Dumble, but you can get some of the vibes of a Dumble into an overdrive channel if you do the right thing. So we sat there, and Paul would break out his glasses and the soldering irons. He'd be like, I think I got it. And I'd try, I'm like, let's try it one more time, and I think I got it. And so he sat in there like a mad scientist with Doug Sewell, who also was designing the amp with me.
Yeah.
And Rich Hannon from PRS would be kind of the product manager, and I think we've gone through 30 versions of it by now, and everybody's contributed, but on the big dirty channel, Paul's like, that's your thing, you know,
yeah,
just
yeah.
like with the MTP.
He trusts you, you
yeah.
know, especially when you're putting in the work on stage and all
yeah.
that as well for it. I know you've talked about this a little bit, and you know we understand the reasons why we won't see it. But that is this, you know, custom PRS that we've seen. You know, you bring on stage a few
yeah.
times, an incredible looking Explorer
yeah.
inspired instrument. Now we know from what you've said in the past that, you know, it maybe just doesn't make financial sense to make this on a mass production. But could we even see a limited run? You know, 10 of these. You know, like
I've got 4 of them now, and I'll be playing one tonight. It is my favorite guitar.
Wow. Has it got a name?
Stella.
Stella, okay.
Yeah.
Of course,
so
it's Stella.
On the headstock it says Stella, on the truss rod cover. But it plays and sounds incredible. Look, I mean, when you put it on, it just feels great.
Yeah.
Paul, every time I bring it up to Paul, he gets frustrated because, you know, there's a lot of reasons, but one of them is they would have to build all these new CNC machines to build a top. It's a big top, it's a three-piece top. They can't really just make this guitar on one of their other machines. So
yeah.
It would be a big, big upfront cost to get these things made. Unless they're making them all by hand, which would take forever. And if they're making them by hand, people would be paying $10,000 for these guitars. I don't know if that makes any sense. So
I love that you're still pushing.
I'll keep pushing.
Yeah.
You know, we'll see. Maybe one day Paul will give in.
Yeah, yeah. Amazing. But we're hoping that's definitely going to happen.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned Stella there, and of course, a big inspiration for these incredible shows that you did
yeah.
towards the end of last year was for Stella and the charity. But in its own right, an incredible record, incredible performances, and you know, I caught you at the London show. What an incredible night that was.
Oh,
you know,
you
really made it. You made everyone feel like it was a big family.
Yeah.
You know, it was a lovely event. And just talk about how special that, because you've played so many shows, and I've seen so many great Altbridge shows.
Yeah.
Never got to see Creed, as you know, but I would have loved to have seen that. But this felt like one of the most important shows
yeah.
of your career.
I think the record was, the Sinatra record was probably one of the most satisfying records I've ever done. It was, you know, we've raised over $1 million with it. I've gotten to see firsthand what it does.
Yeah.
And I absolutely love it. I'm doing another show on July 15th in Chicago. Every show is raising money, further money for the charity. I'm trying to get other artists to do something similar to keep on raising funds. So if anybody's watching this, you know.
Of course, yeah, we'll be dropping the links in the description, that's for sure, for that. And could we see a follow-up record?
Yeah, you know, I just, a month or so ago, I went to Nashville and I sang for the grand opening of the Sinatra Bar and Grill in Nashville. Yeah. And I sang for Tina Sinatra and Charles Pignon, who runs the Sinatra estate. So when I was singing, I sang my way, and my wife's about 20 feet ahead of me, and Tina Sinatra comes over and holds her hand as I'm singing my way. I'm like, this is amazing. So after the show, I was speaking with Charles Pignon, who runs the family business, and he's like, you know, pretty much reach out to me when it's time for volume two.
Yeah, brilliant.
So I was talking with Trisha Yearwood, who was there, and she was also wanting to do a volume two. So hopefully we can collaborate on something.
Yeah, you know, well, we'll definitely be keeping an eye out on that, that's for sure. And just before I let you go, because something I've always assumed that you guys must have played together, but I didn't know for sure, but did the Mayfield Four, you know, play with you guys?
Yeah.
Play with Creed?
Yeah.
Like, was that your first experience of Miles?
It was. Yeah, they opened up for Creed back in the day, and he was just this incredible singer that everybody's like, you got to go out and hear this guy. And then when the wheels started falling off Creed at the end, my best friend at the time, who's passed away now, he took me for a ride in his car. He's like, remember this Mayfield Four singer? Because I was talking about having to find a singer. He played me Summer Girl. And at the end of Summer Girl, he hits these crazy notes. And I was like, all right, we got to hunt him down. So he was actually hit up by Velvet Revolver, I think, previous to that.
Yeah.
And then we reached out, and he flew down, and history's made.
Rest is history, absolutely. Yeah. And any plans yet at this point for any more new material? Because obviously as soon as something new comes out, you guys are touring the world with it and keeping that alive.
Yeah.
But there's always that desire for new music.
I'm always writing, you know. I don't know sometimes what I'm writing for. I'm just writing, so.
Yeah. Does that get harder at this stage, you know?
I know if it's a metal thing, it's going to be the Tremonti band. But, you know, if I write something that I really enjoy but I can't sing it because I've got too much going on the guitar, or I just am not delivering it well, I'll save that for Miles, you know. So
I'd love to see you do something with, I mean, you know that way you're such a, not only a great player, songwriter, singer, all the stuff, but you're a real guitar aficionado, you know. You've got love for players like Guthrie Govan and Steve Vai and all these guys. You ever thought about doing any type of collaboration like that where you have, you know, bringing in some guest guitarists
to
work with you?
Yeah, you know, maybe one day we'll have somebody guest on a record or something.
Even on a solo record, I feel like that would be a lovely, like,
that would
the
be great.
Combination of what, the way you write and your own solos, but to have that, you know.
Yeah, there's definitely, the only thing I worry about is if I invite somebody, then my other guitar buddy's like, what the hell, man? Why didn't you invite me? I played with you all these years.
You got too many friends at this point. That's for sure. And a final thing. I always have a Creed question, you know. And I know, like, but I won't press it. But you know, are we thinking that that's it at this point? You know, a lot of years since that final record now, which was incredible because, you know, at the time it felt like a long time between Human Clay and the follow up.
Uh-huh.
But now it's been such a long time.
Yeah, yeah.
You think that door is closed?
You never know, man. It's all a matter of timing and making stuff work. There's a lot of the more bands that we're getting involved in, the more agents and managers that each person has, it makes things more complicated. But I just bury my head in the sand and try to be the artist and let them deal with it. And if they have something good to present, we'll.
I love it, man. Never say never, eh? Yeah,
that's
the way. Nice one. But look, Mark, always a pleasure. Thanks so much.
Absolutely.
And we'll catch you down the road.
Thank you, man.